Heavenly Father, I humbly beseech you to see before you a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, and a sinner of your own redeeming, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Today is the first Sunday after the Ascension, a great holy and feast day of the church, and so we have moved our lessons of the Ascension to today. Ascension is the feast of the church when we celebrate the risen Christ's embodiment, embodied engulfment by heaven, if you will. St. Basil the Great explains the Ascension in his thoughts on the Holy Spirit, and I'll paraphrase it so it's a little easier to understand, but it is this is our restoration, he writes, our own ascension, where we are taken in as adopted members in the family of heaven, where we are freed to call God Father, to be known as children of light. It is, the Ascension is, if you will, our reception of God's grace. What is so important here is what God is doing. Jesus, the human, embodied flesh of the incarnation, is taken into the heart of God. This seems to me to be a deep and powerful understanding of how God is engaging with us, engages us. And I'm suggesting here that what is happening is that the most visible, if you will, the most tangible person of Jesus disappears from the human world in its former shape and is somehow absorbed into the endless life of God. And I'm parroting here the words of Archbishop and theologian Rowan Williams. This is how the finite always will point now to the infinite, and how the infinite consumes the finite. This is natural. This is a natural thing, as God is the creator of all things through the incarnation, the second person of the Trinity, as we say and we'll even rehearse today in our creed. But as St. Gregory of Nyssa speaks of it, it is the whole cosmos that belongs to God. This is not indeed a strange thing, then, a strange world that God is taking into God's self, but the earth which God had established upon the foundation of the seas, writes Gregory. All the beauty of matter, all the beauty of the cosmos, of the body human, is taken into God. And so too are the dark places taken up, the hidden places of our inner secrets, private sins, the brokenness of each human being, even the tortured and beaten persons, the bruised bodies captured in the body of Jesus, terror and death itself consumed by God. This opens our eyes to reflect upon, as Williams argues, and our ears and our hearts to be open to the full range of what being human means. So that instead of being somebody who needs to be sheltered from the truth of the world or the different bodies in the world, the Christian, you see, is somehow one who should be more open, more vulnerable to the great human being experience and the different ways in which humans embody life. Here are the stories of suffering and pain, the stories of fear and anxiety, of brutality, of hunger, poverty, suffering, yes. But it's also of the beauty of humankind in its diversity. The suffering that we incur is taking up, the suffering we inflict, the brokenness we feel and the brokenness that we have made. Like the old Clint Eastwood film, God takes into God's self the good, the bad, and the ugly of humanity into the heart of God. Yet there is more. Our bodies are taken up. The bodies of the young, the bodies of the old, the bodies of the cancer-strewn, the stroke immobile, the Parkinson-affected, the Alzheimer's forgotten are all taken up into God, as are the whole spectrum of human bodies, every type. every color, every gender. Here is the difference between science, secularity, versus theology. You see, we may as humans objectify, study, quantify, discern the many variations of what it means to be human. But God says, I will take it all in to myself in the ascension. God in Christ and Christ's ascension embraces all bodies by taking into God's heart the body of Jesus. The diversity of the finite, you see, is taken into God's heart, God's infinite being of love. The nature of the ascension of our Christ-shaped body, the church, then, has a particular mission that echoes the theology of the ascension. This mission is to take up with the lives of others, such that our communal body, our corporate nature, engulfs the lives of those around us with love, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Here is a church of God's sinners, right? It's not a church of God's perfected ones, but it's a church of everybody. This is an embodied mission that cannot take shape through introspection and spiritual discipline alone. This is not going to happen by wishing it were so, but instead we have to embrace the whole of humanity that is around us, to embrace it with the act of love and living within shared spaces with one another. Again, as Christ's corporeal body in the world, the church, we are invited to embody God's love, to go where the broken are, to love the unlovable. And I know you have the list. I have a list, right? To love those who are cast out, or that we think should be cast out. To love those who feel shame. To love those who are unwelcome. Those whom we have not welcomed. To love even our adversary. See, you don't get out that easy with the ascension and God. No, all of this is our work, says the Lord. For us, the embodying means to eat with, to enjoy life together. To enjoy life together with your adversary. Try that on. To move beyond the dividing lines of human nature, for there are many within our own creation, to move beyond tribal politics and national identities, to embody living life together, enjoying a cup of coffee together, whatever it is. But this is a vision of the kingdom, where the great diversity of human bodies and ideas come together. Sure, we see our own limitations to love others clearly. They're not fooling anybody. And we need courageously to own these limitations. I have my own. You have yours. But we can only be forgiven when we're honest about them. We shouldn't change the story of the gospel to fit our human idea of who should be left out, you see. We should own the fact that our love is frail because it is human and likes to leave others out, but that God doesn't. And so there is a clarity about our sinfulness and our brokenness. As William writes, our compassion then, in understanding the ascension, I would say, our compassion may be deepened 100-fold. Our awareness of pain deepened 100-fold, he says. And please God, he prays, by the gift of the Spirit, our hope is deepened 1,000-fold, that my body, with all of my brokenness, may too be received into the Godhead. We might play a little bit with St. Chrysostom's Easter sermon. Whereas death took the body of Jesus and met God face to face, where death took earth and encountered heaven, where death took that which was seen and fell upon the unseen, so in the ascension, God has taken Jesus' body and loved us face to face. Heaven has taken in matter and encountered that which it has made. God took that which is seen into the unseen. The finite has been taken into the infinite so as to redefine humanity and community forevermore. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.